Welcome to Bible Essentials. Finally, here in chapter 5, Paul changes topics. All right, so if you have your Bible, get it and let's begin reading to find out what Paul has to say in chapter 5. Here it is. It is widely reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and the kind of sexual immorality that is not even condoned among the Gentiles, meaning the heathen Gentiles don't even condone this type of behavior. What is it? Paul tells us, a man is living with his father's wife. Look at verse 2 with me. And you are inflated with pride instead of being filled with grief, so that he who has committed this act might be removed from among you. I think this is very clear what Paul is saying. This man who is living with his father's wife needs to be removed from among you. You need to deal with it. Instead, you're inflated with pride. Look at verse 3. For though absent in body, but present in spirit, I have already decided about him who has done this thing as though I were present. Meaning Paul says, I don't even have to be there. I've already made up my mind. Here's what needs to be done. Verse 4. In the name of our Lord Jesus, when you are assembled along with my spirit and with the power of the Lord Jesus, here's what he tells them they need to do. Verse 5. Turn that one over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. Why? So that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. Listen, by now you should know what the day of the Lord is. We've read verses on it, but remember, it's synonymous with Christ's second coming when he gathers the Christians, the saved, off the earth to meet him in the clouds so that he can immediately pour out his wrath and judgment on the earth. Look at verse 6. Your boasting, that word boasting is proud, confident, exulting, reasons to glory. He says your boasting is not good. Your confidence, your reason to glory in, you're proud, it's not good. Don't you know that a little yeast permeates the whole batch of dough? Think about Paul's analogy here. He's saying this man's sin is permeating the whole church. Verse 7, what are they to do? Clean out the old yeast so that you may be a new batch, since you are unleavened. And this is what the church should look like inside the church. He's using an analogy of the Passover. For Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us observe the feast, not with old yeast or with the yeast of malice and evil, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Okay, so it is in the best interest of this man to be removed from the church so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. It is in the best interest of the church if they remove this man, because a little leaven leavens the whole batch, right? Look at verse 9. I wrote to you in a letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Are you getting what Paul says? He goes, I wrote to you not to associate with sexually immoral people. Verse 10, by no means am I referring to this world's immoral people or to the greedy and swindlers or to idolaters. Otherwise, you would have to leave the world. He's like, I'm telling you not to associate with sexually immoral people. I'm not talking about those in the world. Verse 11, but now I'm writing you not to associate with anyone who bears the name of brother. In our world, in our language, it would be Christian or Christ follower. He's saying, I'm writing you now not to associate with anyone who bears the name of brother, who is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or a reviler, a drunkard or a swindler. He says, do not even eat with such a person. These are strong, harsh word, but remember that it's for his good and it's for the church's good. It's not to be mean. Verse 12, for what is it to me to judge outsiders? Yeah, those outside the church, we don't judge them. He says, do you not judge those who are inside? Verse 13, but God judges the outsiders. Put away the evil person from among yourselves. Now you might be saying, but Sarah, didn't Paul tell the Corinthians in the previous chapter not to judge? Yes, he did, but we have to keep that in context with which it was written. He is saying that to the Corinthians, to not judge between those apostles. Because remember, they were prideful in who they were associating with. They were saying, I'm with Paul, or I'm with Peter, because maybe Peter spent saw the transformation on the mountain. I don't know, but they were saying, and they were divided between these apostles. And he's saying, you are not to be judging between these apostles. Let God do that when he comes. He will judge the true intentions of the hearts and these men, and then praise will come from God. The context of chapter 4 is not judging between these apostles through whom they believed, thinking the men or themselves were any better than the other. Do you see that? Because yes, in chapter 5, the church is called to judge those only in the church who bear the name of brother or Christian. We're to judge those, and when we see this man, here he is living in sin, he is to be removed. Again, it's in the best interest of the man so that his spirit can be saved and of the church. Don't miss that. We don't hear about this in our churches today, and I don't know, maybe we should. All right, next week we're going to dive into chapter 6. I can't wait.